Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Dear colleagues, a new episode for Pain Relief Educational Channel. Last week, we discussed sciatic pain in pregnancy, causes, symptoms, and management. The link for this episode and the link for Arabic language educational episode for the patients are available in the description of the current video. Today, inshallah, I want to talk about pregnancy-induced sacroiliac joint dysfunction. But I want to focus on how can you, in an easy way, to differentiate between the two conditions, sacroiliac joint pain and sciatic pain. Please subscribe to the Pain Relief Educational Channel to get notification of new episodes and like the video to improve the search for highly needed correct medical information to spread awareness about pain management. Thank you. It is imperative to differentiate between sciatic pain and sacroiliac joint pain for several reasons. First, the referral. As patient with severe sciatic pain should be referred to neurosurgeon or spine surgeon according to the setup of your institution. Then the surgeon refers the patient to pain management clinic if no surgical treatment is needed. On the contrary, pregnancy-induced sacroiliac joint disease should be directed first to the pain consultant, and he or she can request the input of other specialties if needed. This will save a lot of time, especially in a busy practice. Second, management. I'm sure all of you know that sacroiliac joint pain has a different management course compared to lumbar disc disease. So we should first know what's the condition to manage the patient correctly. Third, the mode of delivery and anesthetic technique may differ according to the diagnosis. This is why we should know how to differentiate between the two conditions in an easy and simple way. And that's what I'm going to explain to you in the next few minutes. So sacroiliac joint dysfunction is a common problem during pregnancy. It has been estimated that 50 to 80% of pregnant women will suffer from low back or posterior pelvic pain. The main reason for this pain is instability and dilatation of the sacroiliac joint. Secondary to release of pregnancy hormones, mainly the relaxing hormone. This relaxation or dilatation of the pelvic is needed to allow the pelvis to accommodate the enlarged uterus and allow for head engagement in preparation for delivery. As we all know from the anatomy, the sacroiliac joint has a lot of supportive ligaments. Posteriorly, there are four ligaments: interosseous ligament, posterior sacroiliac ligament, sacrospinous, and sacrotuberous ligaments. Anteriorly, the joint is supported by anterior sacroiliac ligament. Iliolumbar ligament supports the joint from both anterior and posterior. So there's a lot of supportive ligament that supports the joint. And this ligament, when dilated, the joint becomes unstable. Even the patient says that, "I'm feeling I'm unstable, my movement is not, I'm not moving well," because the weight transfer from the upper body to the lower limb is not done correctly. How the symptoms of sacroiliac joint dysfunction differ from symptoms of sciatic pain in pregnancy? Both of them present with back pain and leg pain, but there is a difference that I'm going to explain. So from the history, first, The sacroiliac joint pain, the maximum tenderness is around PSIS, posterior superior iliac spine, as you can see in the photo. While in the sciatic pain, the maximum tenderness is over the lumbar vertebrae. In many cases, the sacroiliac joint pain is associated with groin pain, which is not present in patients with sciatic pain. So first point is the area of maximum tenderness. In sciatic pain, patients with radicular symptoms follow a specific dermatomes. So the patient will tell you my leg pain in this or in this area or that area that follows the dermatomes of L4, L5, S1, or mix of them. In contrast to patients with sacroiliac joint dysfunction, there is a radicular symptoms in many patients, but usually the pain does not cross the knee and the pain does not follow any dermatomal distribution. So the second point is the distribution of the pain in the leg. So number one, in the back, the site of maximum tenderness. Number two is that when the patient tells you, where is my leg pain? So this is from the history. From the examination, we do a straight leg raising test. This will be positive in patient with sciatic pain, but negative in patient with sacroiliac joint dysfunction. And we all know to have a positive straight leg raising test, it should reproduce the leg pain, not the back pain, in the angle between 30 to 70 degrees to say that the test is positive. Other than that, the test is negative. So this will be positive in patient with sciatica. It will be negative in patient with sacroiliac joint dysfunction. Then there are several verification tests to diagnose sacroiliac joint dysfunction. This includes Faber test, that is flexion, abduction, external rotation, as you can see, and the test will be positive for both sacroiliac joint and hip pain. Then we have a compression test that we need to compress the pelvis slightly and slowly for a 5 seconds that need to reproduce the sacroiliac joint pain. So the pain is not be under my hand or the examiner hand, it will be in the sacroiliac joint area. The third test is the distraction test, which you have the press the anterior superior iliac spine posteriorly and laterally for 5 seconds. A steady, gentle pressure. This will reproduce the sacroiliac joint pain if positive. Other than that, it is negative. So the side thrust test, which is the most specific test, you use the femur as a lever to push the ilium posteriorly. And this force will reproduce the pain if present. And last test is the Gensling test, which is one leg is hanging over the bed, the second leg is flexing, and you press on both legs to increase the shear maximum force on the sacroiliac joint. And this test in patients with severe pain is very difficult to do. So you have here 5 tests. You need at least to have 3 tests positive to diagnose the pregnancy-induced sacroiliac joint dysfunction. So we have 2 points in the diagnosis, two points in the history, 2 points in the diagnosis to differentiate. So the area of maximum tenderness, number one. Number two, leg pain distribution. In the examination, we have also 2 points, straight leg raising test, and we have the provocation test. Test for the sacroiliac joint. In short, how can you differentiate between the sciatic pain and sacroiliac joint pain in pregnancy by history and examination only? This should be a very simple for any person who's facing, or for any colleague who's facing these patients in the urgent care or in the ward, to differentiate between the two conditions to make the correct referral. If you have any comment or question, please email me. I will be more than happy to answer you. And thanks for watching this episode.